Radio.tv, bringing you the news before it happens. Stream live into your home via the worldwide internet. Welcome to Prophet.tv, bringing you the latest news from the spiritual front. The following program is being streamed live from Prophet.tv. Join us now for Prophet.tv. Join us now for Prophet.tv. Program already in progress.
Make the phone ring now. Or do all these stupid things. You know, stand in the middle of freeway and see if God doesn't give his angels charge to keep those cars from hitting you, which is just jumping off a cliff, standing in the freeway, same idea. Thou shalt not tempt God. Jesus used the revelations of the truth to keep from getting pulled into error. Okay? The devil challenged his oneness with God. And a little game that I like to do, it's fun, is say, you go like this. I am called to lead multitudes into relationship with my Father. Now watch. Am I called? I am called. Am I called? By just turning the great I am called me. I am called. I am called. When I say I am, it also unifies as I am one in you and you are one in me and we are one in the Spirit. I am called to preach the gospel. I am called. Am I called? Is the beast or the flesh challenging the Spirit, separating? I am is faith. Am I is doubt. But isn't that interesting? Just even in that little game kind of an idea. You're going to prophesy more accurately from a place of I am than you are from am I. And understanding when you're in that place of faith versus that place of doubt. And there are some times when that place of faith is really strong and your prophecies are amazing. And there's other times when there's hindering things and you can't quite get there. And you can step out. Now, how do you know the difference? You got to experiment. Do you guys prophesy? Do you guys all pray in tongues? Yeah? Do you guys ever prophesy to yourself during your prayer time? Do you ever let the Holy Spirit prophesy through you? Okay? That's the next step you need to start practicing. And sometimes, when I first started doing that, I was like, what the heck? Oh, man, you'd be getting some funky spirits trying to come through. Just don't go running off half-cocked is what you get, and don't start a prophetic ministry. Okay? But you need to realize that there was a school of the prophets, because prophets had to learn to prophesy, and they had to learn what spirit they were of, because we can listen to different spirits. You're ready for spiritual meat when you get your, what's the Bible say? When you have your senses exercised to discern both good and evil. I remember when I asked God for the gift of discerning of spirits. God, you said earnestly desire the best gifts. All right, I want the gift of discerning of spirits. And I thought it would be, okay, presto, you can now discern spirits. No, God just let every kind of voice come against me. Thus saith the Lord, you need to go outside right now and jump up and down 10 times and spin around. Stick your head in a trash can. No, I don't think that's God. So then they get more subtle. You follow what I mean? And you hear all kind of goofy stuff. You need to start letting the Holy Spirit prophesy through you. Step out, start stepping out in faith and prophesying things. Don't go running off half-cocked. See if it comes to pass, see if it doesn't. Does that make sense? Kind of test it a little bit, but it's okay. It's not a bad thing. I remember, this one was wild. I remember, I'm trying to think of how God said it. You know how we always, I praise you, God, I praise you. God said, I can't remember how he did it, but he turned it around. What was coming out of his mouth was him praising me. And the first time that happened, I thought, oh my God, I'm thinking I'm God, because you're so under that doctrination that, what do you think you are, God? And as soon as I heard him saying, no, I praise you, or whatever he was saying, I was like, oh my God, no, don't worship me. I don't know what, I just started running off half-cock. And God said, hold on, can a father praise his son? Yeah. Does that make sense? So kind of the first time, but it's important to start getting in a place to where you really can start hanging out with God, and God can start to talk to you and start to prophesy through you. We get the doctrine, we read the Bible, we test the spirits. That's what I'm saying. The spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. That means you don't have to let that thing prophesy through you. You don't have to give a word every 10 minutes. You know what I'm saying? In other words, they're subject to you, okay? Anyway, was this good? Don't let the devil challenge who you are in God. Don't cast your pearl before swine. I've been getting, the last couple days, I've been getting a lot, I don't know why, a lot of challenges from religious spirits. One guy, I don't know about your doctrine with this bind the strong man. And I'm thinking, now when I was around, I was very aware of how different people are developed into the spirit at different levels, and you can feel how, okay? And I knew that there was a youngerness there, but I just, sometimes for me it can get frustrating because it's kind of like, didn't we do this back in kindergarten? I mean, remember Paul was like, you guys are still doing repentance to dead work, which basically meant every meeting was a salvation message. Every meeting was just a salvation message. And Paul's like, you should be on to some meat by now. I mean, shouldn't we look, watch, power of God. Let me show you how to do this now. I mean, come on, all you guys do is the salvation message. It's just the kindergarten thing. I mean, you know, remember what I'm saying? And Paul got frustrated because he was trying to let's go to the next level. How do you prophesy? Let's go to the next thing here. And yet it's important because people do need all of those foundations. So anyway, but I found a lot of times you'll get religious spirits will challenge you when you're flowing in the spirit. I thought it was really interesting. Can I give you one more story and then we'll pray? This one's going to be heavy though. Is that okay? Okay. And this isn't the kind of thing. Jesus, okay. There was a friend of mine that I knew for many years, and he'd been serving on a ministry for a lot of years. He was given a lot of prophecies. You're going to make a movie. You're going to be given $2 million. You're going to make a movie. You're going to do these things. Was in a mode, though, where he was starting to get real bitter, real angry. He wasn't working. He felt like, you know, somebody should give him a car. They gave him a car. He didn't keep oil in it. Motor seized up. Got upset. Somebody should give me a car. They gave him a car again. Same thing. It got to a place where he would not step out in faith. And myself and several people had prayed with him 10 years. And you got to realize we need each other, and we need each other's prophetic utterance, because a lot of times our future sometimes is created by those prayers, okay? Because those things are sent forward to create things. And it's really interesting. He had started to fall back into different areas of sin. I don't want to go into all of that. Okay. I saw him, and I told him a couple times, I said, you are standing on very shaky ground. In other words, I literally saw the earth beneath him. I don't know if you realize this or not, if you've ever seen this in the spirit, but in the spirit, this thing, that's not solid. You are literally standing on the grace or the hand of God. And if you weren't, you could just fall right into the pit. Does that make sense? But just the love and grace of God keeps us from going to that lower level. And I didn't understand why, but he was like very... I just said, you're on very shaky ground. Whatever's going on, you need to deal with some things, because now the Bible says help first the household of faith. Okay? I don't like to sow money into somebody just to throw the money away. Does that make sense? I would rather sow money into somebody who is moving in faith to go somewhere. So, because if you just keep sowing money, you just run out of money. And to put it in a black hole, does that make sense? He had $20. he spent $10 to buy a Kenneth Copeland tape, right? I saw that as a positive mood to get a revelation to build himself up. So I gave him $20. So he spent 10, and now he's got 30, right? Because he had the, okay. And it was the same thing. He was an actor, and same thing, trying to get him to step out, trying to get him to do, not just to give him handouts, to give him a car, but to get him walking toward fulfilling his destiny. So I said, okay, we'll get your headshots. If you will get him down there and duplicate him, I'll pay for him. But you get on a bus, you get down there and you make the phone call. He was trying to get him moving forward. At one point, he's going to all the meetings. He got a prophecy. He's getting the prophecies. He's waiting for him to fulfill. Listen, faith without works is dead. Prophecy is not so you sit on your butt. It's to help you have a vision when you don't have a vision. It's to give you a hope. Write the vision down. You listen to it. Well, if I'm doing that, then therefore I'm going to have to go get my shaved. I'm going to have to make the steps toward fulfilling that vision. I said, oh, you're going to do a movie? I said, great. I said, why don't you come over and you can use my computer and work on your script? No, I don't know. I don't like computers. I'm not going to use computers. I said, everybody uses. You need to learn computers. It's going to be important. No. I'll just hire somebody when I get the $2 million. So he's just sitting day after day waiting for his $2 million because of the prophecy. And I said, well, why don't you get a typewriter? Shouldn't you write your script? No, I'll just hire somebody. Okay, trying to get right, moving in faith. And sometimes you can see this when you get caught in this whole religious thing. Basically, he calls me up and he's complaining because his car is blown up, and he had gotten a job off some of these actor things for some extra work. It's only 50 or 75 bucks, but he's making some money finally. Now, we had, me and several people, he was around some very anointed people, had prophesied for his family, had prophesied for his, wife, that he would have a wife, that he'd have kids, that he'd have a car, he'd have a beautiful home, that a career, boom, 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 all these things. And I was explaining to him, I said, listen, the devil is only looking for the weapon form that will prosper to stop you guys from fulfilling that destiny. Now, the Bible says no weapon formed will prosper, right? Is the Bible true? Do you see weapons formed that do prosper against Christians? Well, is the Bible true? Well, what's going on? Easy. These are the revelations that go in your bricks around Jerusalem. And the truth and that knowledge is what sets you free. And it's also what resists the attack that would try to stop us. All right? The revelation on no weapon formed will prosper is when you believe it, you will not let anything stop you. No weapon formed against me will prosper. Now, whatever weapon formed stops you from fulfilling your goal. And that's why Jesus didn't go chasing demons. He went for the goal. And when the devil got in front, he said, get behind me, get behind me. To him who overcomes, get behind me, get behind me. He let no weapon form prosper. Bam, 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 bam. Just kept taking it. If there's a weapon that formed that prospers will stop you, the devil will keep using that weapon. The weapon that was prospering against this brother was this issue with cars. And they would give him a car. He wouldn't take care of it. It would blow up. He wouldn't go. He would sit. And I finally explained this whole concept to him, and I said, you need to get on a bus and get to that actor job and make some money and get off your butt, and quit living in this fantasy world of this stuff. Yes, you'll have that $2 million to your film if you get off your butt and you start sowing into it. I said, you need to, get on a bus, call a taxi, call a friend. I said, if all it takes to stop you from fulfilling your destiny is to hit your cars are going to be attacked one after the other. Why do you think every one of your cars are attacked? It's all that it takes. Now, it's really interesting because I've ministered to a lot of people on blaspheming the Holy Spirit, right? And a lot of people get all freaked out. Oh, I blasphemed the Holy Spirit. Oh, I did the unforgivable sin. It's really interesting. God taught me something in this next moment. keep in mind, he had started to open back up to sin, so there was other spirits in him, and there was always this jealous rivalry. He was comparing himself to the way God was using me. We're not supposed to compare ourselves. We're different. We're different. I'm unique. You're unique. Nobody's better than the other. They're just uniqueness. As soon as you realize you're unique, you become like way cool. It's when you don't realize you're unique, does that make sense? That your own doubt darkens the star that's in you, the Holy Spirit, the fire. It's when you start agreeing with him that you're unique, that you're special, that you're significant, okay? But he couldn't get focused on how significant he was because he was too busy comparing or lusting after his neighbor's wife, coveting. Does that make sense? It's the same idea. What it's doing, all those ideas are saying, you're not focusing on who you are. And when you focus on how great you and me and your life and what we're doing, that's going to draw people to you. But when you keep trying to go after other things, does that make sense? Anyway, so I told him, I said, the only weapon, I said, the devil has found a weapon form that's working. I said, I learned if I don't like the weapon I'm getting hit with, don't let it stop me. Oh, man, I don't like that happening. I'm going to go take 10 people through deliverance and set up, 10 more minutes. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to do exactly the opposite. You hit me. Oh, I don't like that. I'm going to hit you 10 times harder. Don't you ever. And you hit it again. I'll hit you 20. You know what I'm saying? It's like you step up the ante. That one, we're going to get over this real quick. This don't work. Because he's only looking for the, oh, you hit my relationship, bum, bum, bum. I'm out there, calling up people, praying for cancers and seeing them healed. You know, whatever. You don't let the weapon formed. That's the correct revelation. Okay, as I'm telling this, he all of a sudden said, you're a false prophet. And he said that on the phone to me. Within an instant, I had never experienced this. All of my vision for his future disappeared. And in an instant, I knew he was never going to get married. He was never going to have kids. He would never have the automobile. He would never have the house. He would never produce the film. I didn't prophesy it. I didn't pray it. I didn't speak it. When he spoke that to me, who was ministering to him? That was the Holy Spirit. Those were revelations of the kingdom. Those were things that God was what I call prophetic targeting, accurately targeting the problem to bring revelation as to how to overcome the enemy in his life to win. And he turned and said, you're a false prophet. And I immediately saw no future. And the Holy Spirit said, your ministry to him is done. In other words, I can't do anymore. I can preach and I can hand him tracts and come on. Your real ministry under the anointing was finished. I didn't understand what was going on. So I just got off the phone and he said, your ministry's done. I saw him 2 weeks later at a Christmas party. And during Christmas to New Year's, I get a phone call. Don, your friend's dead. He died. It was amazing. Now, God showed me that he ended up in heaven. But it was really amazing, and I was trying to understand what happened in that moment that he turned on the anointing. That's what he did. He turned on the anointing. It wasn't my personality that was just coming up with some good ideas. Now, a lot of times when people are ministering to us, Don't you know that a lot of stuff is real soulish and they just quote a bunch of scriptures and stuff, and it's not the same thing as when there's a prophetic revelation and it's the Spirit actually helping. You know the difference, right? Can you tell the difference? Like you turn on TBN and you can come by one of the ministries and you feel the fire of God. You come by somebody else and fear, condemnation, the world's blowing up and you're like, that ain't God. You know what I'm saying? You can recognize the actual presence of God versus just another type of doctrine. Okay. What he did is he turned on the anointing. And I thought that was amazing. And all of a sudden, in going back and looking at those scriptures, Jesus said, he was ministering by the Holy Spirit. He wasn't pushing a form of doctrine. He wasn't pushing a thing. He was actually flowing by the Spirit. And what happened is they started coming against Jesus, the person. And Jesus said, you can come against me in the flesh. You can come against Don Paul. You can come against God in heaven. But if you can't recognize when it's the Holy Spirit ministering to you, and you can't even recognize God's Spirit, and you turn on God's Spirit, who's going to raise you from? There's no other place. You know what I'm saying? And so sometimes we're not taught to recognize when the Holy Spirit ministers. And I think the thing that grieves me the most in ministry is when I'm in a flow by the Holy Spirit and you're talking to the religious that are under the doctrine. And they don't recognize the Holy Spirit, but they start challenging the doctrine because they don't know the Spirit of God. Does that make sense? And I think that probably grieves. It grieves the Holy Spirit because basically in an instant, they make all the supernatural anointing that was available to give them revelation, heal them, make something created in the Spirit is void. And now we're just in a doctrinal debate and God is gone. And at that point, I'm gone too. I can't. Last thing I want to do is sit here and argue about this stuff. I have a life to lead. Well, you're a pastor. I said, no, I'm a human being. I have a life. I'm simply here to impart what God has taught me. But you want to argue doctrine, it's like, it's a waste of time. Now, a young believer that wants to genuinely learn, that's different than somebody that's trying to prove that their doctrine is better than you. That's an intellectual pride thing. Okay? And so you run into a lot of these things. Anyway, God is just good. He's really, really good. He's fascinating. He's wonderful to be around. He's the best friend you could ever have. And all things are possible with him. And he's just wonderful. And sometimes I just can't say it enough, you know? I just want to give him the glory. Anyway, was this fun? Was it kind of interesting? Anybody feel edified? You know, like I said, it was a really interesting thing. I had never experienced that before. There was a competition or a rivalry or a jealousness. At one point, you know, a couple years earlier, he said, oh, yep, so-and-so was sick. God showed me they're going to die. And I said, well, they're not going to die. Oh, yes, they were. And all of a sudden, now he's putting his faith toward them dying to prove that he had the anointing. And I thought, oh, boy, he doesn't understand. And I said, I tried to explain, you know, husbands and wives do this all the time. They will try to prove who's right. And so they put, okay, let me first set this up. If you've got a sick person in a room, right? Person A says God will heal him. Person B says God won't heal him. Which one's in faith? Both. One believes God will heal. One believes God won't. Jesus called that one's belief, faith with the devil, was doubt against God. But his faith was lined up with the devil, with the dark side. Now, there really is no such thing as unbelief. Do you realize that? Consciousness means you're believing something. When you're awake and conscious, you are projecting a faith of some sort. Life's a bitch and then we die. Everybody wants me. Whatever the people's realities are, they are projecting something. So there is always a resonance of a type of faith. Now the idea is to get that faith aligned with God's faith. And then we see incredible things and we quit believing for stupid things. But come on, I see a pastor's wife and her husband. And here's a typical one. We're back to the law. The pastor's wife, you know, the way the thing went, he was just kind of flowing. He wasn't like trying to stay on the clock. He was just kind of in a flow place. Yet part of her religious structure was, I'm never late. I'm always on time. I'm right on schedule. Remember we talked about that earlier, how we get the Ten Commandment laws, but plus we get all these other added laws. All right. Now, the whole way over there, we're not going to get a parking place. It's not going to work. Prophesy, 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 prophesy. Honey, it's just fine. It's going to work out. No, it's not. You're going to see. Two faiths. Now, what happens when the anointing starts coming on? You've got two realities trying to manifest, and husbands and wives get tricked into this all the time, and I think it's so boneheaded stupid that they can't realize that here's where you are in this moment. What's the best thing you need? We need a parking place. Let's just get an agreement for a parking place. No. I told you to hurry up. You weren't on time. Because you weren't on time, you're going to see. And then they push enough faith to where it comes to pass, and then they nag them more. See, I told you. But yet, it didn't have to. And I saw this happening back and forth, and I'm in the back seat going, they don't understand what's going on here. And I said, because the wife has been a friend of mine for years, and I said, hold on. I said, and I explained this concept to him about the two, faith, both believing for faith. I said, what's the best thing that could happen right now? Well, we need a parking place. I said, I know, me too, because I'm in the car. We all need a parking place. Let's just agree that God will perfectly time it out and we'll get a parking place, okay? Do you want to know what? We not only got a parking place, we were the first ones there. Do you understand what I'm saying? All right. This friend of mine, we're on the phone at another time, and it was the same thing. He said, oh, well, the person's sick, and God has told me that they're going to die. And I said, well, I don't want to oppose you here, but she's not going to die. And he started going into this thing, and he didn't understand. So I had to say, listen, let me put it to you this way then. Just in case, I could be hearing the wrong spirit, but you could too. Because I already knew that he was trying to prove to me that he was a prophet, that he could hear the spirit. And I thought, man, you're getting tricked by the devil to access your faith. And I finally said, what do you want to happen in her life? Well, I want her to live. I love her. And I said, good. I said, can we go wrong, even if that was God saying she's going to die, can we go wrong to start agreeing and believing that she'll live? No, I guess not. I said, okay, good. Let's just believe that, and let's not get caught up trying to prove a point. Okay? And, of course, she lived. Okay. Does that make sense? The idea was, when he turned and said, you're a false prophet, he turned not against me, he turned on the anointing. And sometimes when I deal with pastors and people that don't recognize the Spirit, but they know their doctrine, and they are protecting their sheep, so they're on the lookout for the wolves, right, and all that kind of stuff that goes on, but they don't recognize the Spirit, I think it grieves me a lot when you're actually flowing in the anointing, but they don't recognize the anointing because they know the doctrine. They don't have the supernatural in their church. They don't understand the Spirit. They got the head knowledge. They know how to, you know, they're a kindergarten teacher. They can give you the basics, but they can't then take the basics and cross over into what Paul said, put your faith in that power that just hit you. And so I think that grieves me probably the most, because it cuts off the Holy Spirit from having access to his people. Doctrine has controlled them, but the Holy Spirit doesn't have access. And then you watch the Holy Spirit work on young believers, and they'll start to try and flow, but then the leadership won't understand that, and crushes them. And a good place that you'll see that in the Bible is Ezekiel 19. What is your mother? She's a lioness. She, you know, this is the prophet's lament. It's a great sorrow. And talks about how the Holy Spirit basically comes alongside a young believer, raises them up. They start moving in the anointing. They start exposing the desolate palaces, which would, you know, the haughty mansions of the intellect. Does that make sense? The doctrinal pride. And then, bang, the system comes under, crushes it, and then they submit and become part of the system. And I'm not saying we don't get along, it's not it at all, but it is about knowing the Spirit of God. You know, the whole key is about knowing the Spirit of God. You know, yes, you got to know the Word, you got to have the Word, but I found out from listening to Christian radio and TV as a young believer, when I actually started to try to organize the puzzle of information I was getting, all these different schools were disagreeing. I said, they're all over the place. Sure, half of them don't believe in the Spirit. Half of them, you know what I'm saying? They're all over the place. I just shut off the Christian radio, shut off Christian TV, and I got the Bible, and I went with the old King James, because A, it's a little bit further back on the translation. B, it was written before all this latest rapture theory stuff, where they've all adjusted the words to work with that. But C, it's a little harder than these and thous. It doesn't explain everything to me, to where I have to kind of say, huh? And I have to think. I have to meditate. I have to pull on him more. And then I'm pulling on the Spirit, and that's the whole point. My children are taught by my Spirit. So did I go through Church on the Way, Jack Hayford, you know what I'm saying? I went to the King's Institute for a short time. Life in the Spirit, Catherine Coleman, Tommy Hicks, Bob Cathers, LFCC, Kenneth Hagin, you know what I'm saying? Yes, mentors. Does that make sense that I got licensed under and the whole thing? So absolutely. The other thing is, when you're around mentors, there's a huge impartation that more than just doctrine from being around the actual anointing. Does that make sense? You guys are getting more from the Spirit of God than anything I could do, because it's just the anointing that bears witness, you know, or that actually plants things in our spirit, man. So it's just cool. But that's how Elisha, how did the mantle that was on Elijah go to Elisha? He listened. He sat on him. He served that. He who brings a cup of water to a prophet in the name of a prophet receives the reward, the anointing that's on the prophet. You know, same thing. It says that the revelations of the kingdom are the priceless pearl that we sell everything to go purchase. One of the ways that I got the anointing was to sow into it. You know, people that had an anointing that I wanted, man, I sowed into it. When I saw levels of warfare that I knew were affecting the kingdom, I like to sow into the ministries that were into the heaviest warfare. Why? Because I realized that if the devil starved them out and took them off the line, I was the next one going to get hit. So I was real happy to keep them supplied and up on the front line so I didn't have to be as a young believer. Because I realized if he could take them out, this line, the next line of defense had not been prepared yet. Does that make sense? They were still being raised up. The devil could take that, take that, take that. So I knew that I needed to keep those frontline people in place. I knew I needed to hold covenant with them. Just like David, the army held covenant with David. Anyway, a lot of things. So, again, the anointing comes on, sowing into the anointing, praying, you know, all the different things. And when you just simply receive a prophet in the name of a prophet. So, yeah. Anyway, I think was that a lead-in for an offering? I think so. I didn't expect that. I was just like, oh, okay, God, you know what you're doing. So let me pass this around, and then let's do some praying.
You've been watching Prophet.TV. Please join us next time as we continue to bring you cutting-edge spiritual technology. If you want to have your spiritual weapons sharpened, be sure to tune in to the next episode of Prophet.TV. If you'd like more information, call 818-994-4007. 818-994-4007. You've been listening to Prophet.TV. You can join us live right now on the World Wide Web at Prophet.TV. Again, www.prophet.tv is where we sharpen your spiritual weapons using the latest in spiritual technology. This is Seamus from Dublin, and you've been listening to Prophet.TV. Please join us next time as we continue to bring you the latest in cutting-edge spiritual technology.